Yeah. Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to our service today. As part of our service, we are celebrating communion, and so please do get some bread and wine ready for later on in our service. But thanks again for logging in and joining us today. If you've joined us via our Facebook page, then please do feel free to leave prayers, questions, or comments. And you can do that also if you've joined us directly from YouTube. You have to subscribe to the channel before you can leave comments in the YouTube channel. It is free to subscribe. Fraser has chosen our call to worship today, and he's going to read that to us now. Thanks, Fraser.
It says in Micah, "With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgressions, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God."
Let's now join together as we commit ourselves to God in prayer. Almighty God and loving Father, we come together in prayer as a people scattered by a pandemic, but united in spirit through Christ. Meet with us today, we pray. Open our ears to hear your voice. Open our hearts to receive from you. And strengthen our wills to be obedient to you, in the name of Christ Jesus, our King. Amen. Well, our Bible reading for today is from St. Paul's letter to the Galatians. I want to read this morning from Galatians chapter 3, verse 26 through to verse 29. Galatians 3:26 says, "For you are all children of God through faith in Christ Jesus. And all who have been united with Christ in baptism have put on Christ, like putting on new clothes. There is no longer Jew or Gentile, slave or free, male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And now that you belong to Christ, you are the true children of Abraham. You are his heirs, and God's promise to Abraham belongs to you." Before we take time to reflect on those words of St. Paul, we join together in a time of intercessory prayer where we pray for our world. And we're going to be led in that prayer today by Lorna. Thank you, Lorna.
Well, good morning, everyone. I hope you're all doing well at this time. It's a pleasure to be back in the church to do this prayer today. You know, I've been coming here for 49 years to this church, and if you were all in here this morning, I could hear all the sarky comments and the little sniggers right now. But unfortunately, you're not here, and I miss you. But we don't need to be together in person to be the body of Christ. We are one family, just like any other family, even though we're apart. I want to read from Philippians chapter 1, verses 1 to 4. "Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus at Philippi, together with the overseers and deacons. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy. Usually my intercessory prayers are geared towards one of my jobs within the church as missionary secretary. Another one of my more recent roles is as prayer team leader or coordinator. Don't really have a title for it. But I think prayer is one of the most important things a Christian can do at any time, but especially during a pandemic and a lockdown. And just as Paul says, he prays for the Philippians with joy. That's how I think of you when I pray for you too. I read recently that joy, Christian joy, is deep. It's a smile that's not only on the lips, but in the heart. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, how can we sufficiently thank you for the joy that you have deposited in our souls? We thank you that the joy that comes from God is something that can never be taken from us. At this time, many in our church family may be fearful. Lord, your word has said you have not given us a spirit of fear, but of power. Help us to experience that strength that comes from you in our weakness. Many have suffered disappointments. Weddings and other celebrations have been postponed. May they feel your peace and joy at this time. Some of our family have suffered bereavement. Let them come to the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort. And for those who have sickness in their bodies, minds and emotions, I pray for healing and restoration. For those that are feeling lonely, isolated, overwhelmed by their circumstances, may your Spirit come alongside them and encourage them and build them up. And for those who are struggling financially or have lost jobs, worried about their studies and their future, provide for them, your children, for you are a great Father. Lord, I pray for a supernatural comfort and strength to be bestowed on all your family here in Denny, whatever their circumstances. And Lord, I pray earnestly for this world of yours, this planet that you created and made perfect and is now in chaos. Lord, take this virus away. Eradicate it from our towns, our country, our world. We pray for treatments and vaccines, but we know you can destroy it with one swipe of your little finger. So we pray like the psalmist, Lord, have mercy upon us, and all the glory will be yours. But we know you allow situations to continue for your own reasons, and you teach us so much in every circumstance. May we, your church, learn from this and come out of lockdown renewed, more loving and compassionate. We have prayed so often for ways to become more involved in our community, and here you have provided it. Give us wisdom and help us to be more creative and innovative in our approach, and may the world see us differently and be willing to connect and liaise with the church worldwide. And Lord, we pray for the family of George Floyd, who are grieving his loss in America. Lord, we pray they'll turn to you for comfort. We understand the anger that it happened at the hands of those we should be able to trust. But we thank you that most police officers are doing a great and difficult and dangerous job. We pray fervently for the tensions to ease and demonstrations to be peaceful, that there would be a coming together of both sides so that a way forward and reconciliation can be found. And now, Father, bless us this week. Just as you are patient with us and minister sensitively and graciously to us, help us to be like that with others too. And we ask all these things in the powerful and lovely name of Jesus. Amen.
Well, in his Politics, Aristotle wrote that humanity is divided into two, the masters and the slaves. While slavery has been abolished in the majority of countries, the point remains true in its implication of the power structures that still exist, even within supposedly democratic societies. To use Aristotle's terminology, in Western societies today, the masters are overwhelmingly white, and they still control all the levers of privilege and power. And those levers are used disproportionately against people of colour. Over the past year in the USA, there's been a steady flow of the deaths of black citizens at the hands of the police. And that finally reached breaking point with the murder of George Floyd by a Minnesota police officer, whilst his colleagues just stood by and watched. His murder sparked protests that spread across the United States and now are spreading around the world. The response from President Trump has been basically to throw petrol onto the fire. encouraging police forces not to be gentle with the protesters, and indeed warning protesters by quoting a racist governor from the 1960s that when the looting starts, the shooting starts, and all the veiled threat that implies. Not surprisingly, perhaps, social media is now filled with videos of violence and the excessive use of force by police and the National Guard. President Trump also ordered the use of tear gas and rubber bullets to be used to disperse very peaceful demonstrators from outside the White House so that he could walk to a nearby church for a photo opportunity of him holding up a Bible upside down. It's unclear what his intentions were, but the use of the Bible for political reasons has outraged many of his own supporters. The Word of God was reduced to the status of a political prop, as though to suggest that God supports the gassing and shooting of people protesting peacefully against injustice. Now, it would be easy to say that this is purely a political matter. It's a matter of another country's internal politics, and it's none of our business, and we should politely keep out of it. But that would actually not be true. Firstly, it is our business. As Afua Hirsch suggested in The Guardian this week, the racism that we see in America today was built in Britain. Modern expressions of racism trace their roots to the slave trade, which was controlled by the British and made the UK very rich indeed. And that includes Scotland, by the way. In fact, the ship that brought Bonnie Prince Charlie to Scotland was owned by a slave trader, quite a well-known slave trader. Secondly, the church has much to repent of in regard to racism. For the church sanctioned slavery as a means of Christianizing the heathen, and no doubt the church also benefited from the riches that it brought. We are not innocent in this matter. And thirdly, and most importantly, racism is contrary to everything that the Bible teaches. Its roots lie in the original sin of Lucifer. It is a denial of the gospel of Jesus, and its eradication is part of the mission of the church in advancing the kingdom of Christ in the world. So today, this is very much on all our news screens. I want to take a few moments to look at what the Bible might have to say about it. So what do I mean by saying that racism finds its roots in the original sin of Lucifer? Ezekiel chapter 28 contains an oracle against the king of Tyre. Isaiah chapter 14 contains an oracle against the king of Babylon. And whilst these texts are much debated, there is general agreement that they are also alluding to the fall of Lucifer. They suggest that Lucifer was great in the kingdom of heaven, but that iniquity or wickedness was found in him. What was that iniquity? It was and is the idolatry of the self. Lucifer thought of himself as superior to everyone and everything else. As the Apostle Paul puts it, he thought more of himself than he ought to have. In fact, Lucifer thought he was so great that he would be able to take and ought to take the place of the Most High God. I've said several times recently that the idolatry of the self is the most insidious of all idolatries. It is foundational to all the others. And racism is an expression of that sin, because at its heart, racism is to think of oneself as superior to another. And when you think of yourself as superior to another, the next step is to think that you can treat that other as you wish. And that was Lucifer's sin, that he thought he was better than God and that he ought to take the place of God. The slave traders and the slave owners thought of the slaves as barbarian and subhuman, and thought then they were able to treat them as they wished because they were inferior. Why is that a sin? Well, it's a sin because of the image of God that exists within humans. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, God says, "Let us make man in our image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them." What does it mean to be made in the image of God? We could be here for many weeks answering that question. But the late, great Stanley Grenz encapsulates the theological debate on this issue when he writes that we are the image of God as we mirror in creation the nature of the Creator. God exists as a Trinity with no division of status or hierarchy. It naturally follows then that human relationships which are based on hierarchy and power do not reflect the image of God in creation. In fact, they reflect the very opposite. What this tells us also is that the dignity and worth of a human being is found not in race or indeed in any other category. It is found solely in the fact that each and every human being is equally made in the image of God and bears the image of God and is called to reflect the image of God in creation. Importantly, both Adam and Eve are commanded to rule over the earth. They're given equal worth, equal value, and equal status in creation. They are commanded to rule over the earth. They are never commanded to rule over one another. So before the fall, man and woman existed as equals with no hierarchy or power or authority structure between them. They lived in unity and harmony with one another and with God. And in doing so, they reflected the image of God that they bore in their creation. So both shared in God's image, both shared the same responsibilities in creation. And it's in this way that they reflected the image of the Creator within that creation. The fall into sin did not remove that image, but it did mar it. And so as a result of the fall, destructive and divisive attitudes like racism, hierarchies, power structures, all become part of the human experience, leading to injustice and oppression. It should be noted, therefore, that the unity of the human race in creation is mirrored by its unity in sin. This is signified not only by the picture of Adam and Eve being expelled from the garden together, but also by the Apostle Paul's teaching in the opening chapters of Romans. It's explicitly stated in Romans chapter 3 and 23, "All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." So not only are we created equal, but we are all equally guilty of sin before God, all equally deserving of his just wrath and judgment. But racism is therefore also a denial of the gospel of Jesus Christ. One of the facets of that gospel is that in Jesus Christ, God is creating a new humanity, one that finds its unity and equality that was intended in the garden. It rediscovers that unity and with union in Christ. The truth of this is made explicit in our scripture text from Galatians, a letter written to combat a form of racism that was taking hold in the Galatian church. I'll give you the short version. A group of Jewish Christians were suggesting that they were the true Christians, the real Christians, because of their Jewish ethnicity and heritage. After all, didn't Jesus say in John 4:22 that salvation is from the Jews? So they were suggesting that the identity markers of Judaism, of Jewishness, circumcision, the Torah, cleansing rituals and so on, other Jewish practices were essential in order to be truly Christian. In response to that, Paul writes what is easily his most scathing letter to correct these views, because such thinking is both contrary to the gospel and to his ministry and calling as an apostle to the Gentiles. A Gentile is anyone who is not a Jew. Scholar Gordon Fee writes that for Paul, the crisis in the Galatian church had to do with whether Gentiles get in on the promises of Abraham without also taking on Jewish identity, especially those marks of identity that specifically distinguish Jews from Gentiles. It's thought that Galatians 3:28 is a deliberate attempt by Paul to counter the three berakot, or blessings, that appear at the beginning of the cycle of Jewish morning prayers. They go along these lines: "Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of the universe, who has not made me a foreigner," that is to say, a non-Jew. "Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of the universe, who has not made me a slave." "Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of the universe, who has not made me a woman." When women prayed that last line, they said, "Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of the universe, who has made me according to your will." The three pairs of relationships mentioned in the Berakot were the primary ways in which people were divided from one another in the ancient world. Interestingly, they are also the primary ways that people are divided from one another in the structures of the present age: race, social standing, and gender. As Gordon Fee writes, the point that Paul seeks to make is that in Christ, these categories have lost all structural significance and relevance. That is, these very things that keep people distanced from or at odds with each other in a fallen world have been relativized in the body of Christ, where not only Jew and non-Jew, but also masters and slaves, men and women, all form one body together, equally united in Christ. It is this vision of humanity that's expressed in Revelation chapter 5, verse 9, where, contrary to the Berakot, citizenship of God's kingdom is based not on the basis of ethnicity or nationality or social status or gender. Rather, it is based solely on the fact that people have been ransomed from their sin by the shed blood of the Lamb. For Paul, then, a result of the life, death, resurrection, and enthronement of Jesus as the saving King makes categories like race irrelevant. They have lost all significance in the new creation that Christ has ushered in. Now, Acts chapter 10 is an important passage on this issue. God gives Peter a vision about the so-called clean and unclean foods, and that calms Peter enough when he gets the invitation to go to the house of a non-Jew, Cornelius, and he goes, he accepts the invitation, and he goes and he preaches the gospel. And not only does Cornelius and all his household come to faith in Jesus Christ as the saving King, but they also receive the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit comes upon them in power, just as it did the disciples at Pentecost. And all of this leads Peter to declare, "I see very clearly that God shows no favoritism. In every nation, he accepts those who fear him and do what is right." Likewise, the pouring out of the Spirit at Pentecost showed that the power of God was for all. And we shouldn't miss the fact that Pentecost was a reversal of the events of the Tower of Babel, the first great division of humanity, when man's speech and language was confused and they no longer understood one another. Pentecost and the coming of the Spirit reverses that. The Apostle Paul makes it clear that, most explicitly here in Galatians, that salvation in Christ is independent of all racial, gender, and social divisions. We are saved by faith alone, through grace alone, and are made one in Christ. We are made one people, a new humanity, through our unity with Christ by his Spirit. It's perhaps stating the obvious to say that unity cannot exist where one group is viewed as being superior to another, especially perhaps if the basis of that superiority is nothing more than the colour of a person's skin, given that all persons, regardless of the colour of their skin, have been created in the image of God and they bear his image in creation. Racism, therefore, has no place in any way, any shape, or any form within the Church of Jesus Christ. In view of all of this, we can also say, therefore, that racism is contrary to the mission of the Church in the world. Much of the language in the New Testament around the Church, about the Church, is political language. Our primary declaration that Jesus is Lord is as much a political statement as it is a religious one. For if Jesus is Lord, then all others are not. The Church then is viewed as an embassy of the kingdom of God in hostile territory from which it advances the goals, vision, and values of the kingdom. It advances the message and values of the King. The Church, therefore, has a responsibility not only to condemn racism, which is counter to the gospel of Jesus and does not exist within the kingdom of Jesus. We have to condemn that and to actively work to eradicate it. For our calling as the Church is to bring a foretaste of the kingdom of God, in which all people are equal and live in their essential and real unity in Christ through faith in him, united by the one faith and the one Spirit and the one Lord. As one scholar notes, it is clear from the total message of Scripture that one cannot speak of God's love for us and Christ's sacrifice on the cross without speaking of his righteousness and his justice. Again and again in Scripture, we see that God is on the side of the oppressed and never on the side of the oppressor. He liberates the oppressed and he defends the orphan and the widow, the weakest and most vulnerable in ancient societies. In mirroring the image of the Creator within his creation, we must take a stand against all forms of injustice and discrimination and work towards a fairer, more just world. And as we do this, we are constantly signposting the kingdom of God. We are saying to people, this is what the kingdom of God looks like. This is the life that our King brings. Wouldn't you want to be part of that life and be part of that kingdom? It invites them as we give them a foretaste of the kingdom of God. Getting that foretaste invites them to come under the rule and reign of our King. And so racism has no part in any way, shape or form within the Church of Jesus Christ. And as disciples of Jesus Christ, it is our duty not only to condemn it in word, but to actively work against it. And so I pray that we will not only repent of racism if it exists in our lives and in our congregations, but I pray that we will truly advance the message and the ethos and values of the kingdom that Christ has called us to through his death and resurrection and enthronement as our saving King. Thanks for listening today. As we come now to communion, I want to remind everyone that it too is an invitation. It is an invitation to come and build your life on the rock that is Christ, to come and be part of his kingdom, to know and experience that equality and unity that is found in him alone. And I want to begin by reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. The Apostle Paul gives us instructions as to the manner in which we should take communion. In verse 23 of 1 Corinthians 11, he says, "For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be answerable for the body and blood of the Lord. Examine yourselves, and only then eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For all who eat and drink without discerning the body eat and drink judgment against themselves." Let us pray. Gracious God, we are reminded at this table that the one loaf comes from many grains of wheat, that the one cup of wine comes from many grapes. And so we are reminded of our unity with one another by your Spirit. We are reminded that the church is your body, and that discerning the body means recognizing and valuing equally every member. You have made us one people, and so as one people, scattered by circumstance, we come to remember, to celebrate, and to give thanks for all that you have done for us in Christ. And so we give thanks for the bread and for the cup that speaks so simply and yet so eloquently of your sacrifice for us, for all that you have done, for all that you are doing, and for all that you will yet do. We give you our thanks. Jesus took the bread and he gave thanks for it, and he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Take and eat the bread, and as you eat the bread, remember Christ." In the same way, Jesus took the cup and gave thanks for it, and he spoke of a new covenant in his blood. As we take the cup together, we give thanks and rejoice that though we were lost, we have been found. That though we were alone, we have been made one with the great company of God's people and made one with God in Christ our Lord. As you take the cup, remember him and give thanks. Let us pray together. Lord, we give you thanks today that we are part of your church here in Denny. We pray for your presence to be with us in each of our circumstances during this pandemic. Help us, wherever we are, despite the situation that we are all living through, to bring a foretaste of your kingdom and to work for your justice and your peace in the world. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you for being with us today. If you'd like to know more about being a disciple of Jesus, or you'd like to know more about the work of Denny Baptist Church and how you can support us, then please do contact us through Twitter at Denny Baptist, or via our website at dennybaptist.org.uk, or find us on Facebook. Let's close our time together in our benediction. Lord Jesus Christ, we have remembered your death. We have celebrated your resurrection. We have rejoiced in the wonder of your love for us. Send us out now to proclaim the good news so that others will know that you died for them and in turn will enter into the new life that you offer, and that they will know the love that you so freely give. We ask this in Jesus' name, for his glory and for the common good. Amen. Thank you, and God bless.
Watch and pray, find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.